Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is June 17, 2018. This is the fourth Sunday after Pentecost. It's also Good Father's Day. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. The flowers on the chancel stand are to the glory of God. They were donated by Pastor and Gina in memory of Pastor's Father Jack for Father's Day and his birthday, and in honor and memory of all fathers. Join us at the Clark County Fair coming up in July the 20th through the 27th. St. John's has a booth, and we're located in the Mercantile Building. Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is the 17th of June. It is Father's Day.
Thank you.
and also with you.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. He is Christ, the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God.
The melody of the harp. So we are always confident, even though we know that while we are at home in the body, we are all away from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we do have confidence, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please Him, for all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense for what has been done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade others, but we ourselves are well known to God, and I hope that we are also well known to your conscience. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast in outward appearance and not in the heart. For we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view, even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view. We know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Baker will provide the special music today.
And all 68 Democratic Convention in Chicago, where all people were there protesting against President Nixon or against the Democratic Convention in order to try to make a point, and it turned into a free-for-all. So it was a big brawl. And then, of course, we had the tragedy at Kent State, where students protesting actually were killed in the act of protesting. So God knows what he's talking about. When he tells us to honor our father and mother and all the people, he is doing so because he knows that keeps society on. That lessens your chances of being harmed. I can still remember how fervently I prayed for my dad in the summer of 1968 when Louisville had arrived due to open house. And my dad had to go through part of the ride area to get to where he was teaching summer classes at Spalding University. Fortunately, he made it back and forth. But we've also seen where rides where people have been pulled out of cars and trucks and so forth and beaten. So God knows what he's talking about when he tells us to honor our father and mother. The office of fatherhood is not a mistake. It's not an accident. It's not something that just came about. It was created by God at creation when he made our first parents, Adam and Eve, and made the office of fatherhood and motherhood and gave them responsibilities. One of the responsibilities is that our parents are supposed to represent God in our home, not replace him, not be loved more than him, but to represent. And the fathers are given the burden or the responsibility of training up their children. As St. Paul reminds us in the 6th chapter of his letter to the Ephesians, verse 4, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke, that means to enrage or to exasperate. All of us, if we were fortunate enough to live in a two-parent family, probably can remember times when we were exasperated with our dad, our father, especially when we became a teenager, especially at 14, 15, 16, when we think we know it all, and we've got the answers to everything. At that time in our lives, our fathers really seem old-fashioned, really seem out of it, really seem like there's nothing they can do for us. And so the father has to walk this fine line, St. Paul says. Don't make your children to be exasperated or be enraged. Don't cause them to anger. Actually, that word means to rouse to wrath. In other words, don't be so hard on your children that you cause them to rebel in such a way as that the family bond is broken. You still have to discipline. You still have to instruct. But there is that narrow path you have to walk between being too overbearing or being too lenient. But find that middle. It says, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. That word discipline actually means to train by action. In other words, God has given to the Father the responsibility of training his children through his example, by his actions. And studies have shown, and I used to on Father's Day give those examples from the study that was done, that showed if only one child, or if only one parent goes to the church, the largest, of course, if both parents go to the church, something like 90% of those children will stay in church as they grow up. If only one parent goes, studies have shown if it is a father, a higher percentage of those children will stay in church than if a mother is the only one who goes to church. We see the father is given that responsibility to train by action, train by being an example, to train by being an example not just to their children, but to their fellow family members, to their co-workers, to their friends, to those they're in clubs with or organizations with. Fathers have that responsibility. And that's not an easy responsibility. Because just like mothers, we're human. And we make mistakes. And sometimes we overreact. Sometimes we underreact. And so we have this great responsibility that comes to us from God. So we are to honor our fathers and those in authority. But sometimes there may come a time when you have to be disobedient. There is a film I like to show the confirmants on the Ten Commandments. And when you come to the fourth commandment, honoring your father and mother, they show you this incident. That 16-year-old son comes home from basketball. And his dad's sitting there at the table drinking a beer, and he says to his son, he says, "Hey, I'm out of beer." He said, "Joe got up to stop and go knows me. Here, take this money and go give me 2 6-packs of beer." And his son says, "Dad, I can't do that." He said, "He's not going to sell me the beers. He's getting all kinds of troubles and getting me 21. And then the father retorts, which oftentimes people do when they want to get their way, says, "Doesn't the good book say you're supposed to honor your father and mother?" Sure it does. But not when they're telling you to violate the law. Not when they're telling you to do something against God's will. And it's the same with government. We are to be respectful and to honor government unless it tells us to do something against God's will. As Peter said before the Sanhedrin, when they were trying to tell him to quit preaching Jesus, he said, "I have to do God's will." And so, we honor our parents, we honor those in authority, we honor our father, but when they ask us to do that contrary to God's will, then at that time, we can be disobedient. What are the responsibilities then of being a father? We've already read from St. Paul that we are to train up our children. Paul is echoing the words of Proverbs 22:6, when it says, "Train up a child in the way they should go, and when they become old, they will not depart from it." Of course, we don't live in a perfect world. Unfortunately, even Christian children brought up in the way of Jesus have had sometimes of when they become old, turning away. Our prisons are filled with young men who were brought up in church, but for whatever reason, gave in to the devil instead of continuing to follow the command of Jesus. But normally, in most cases, if we train up our children in the way they should go, following Jesus and His words, honoring God our Father, then they will be a productive citizen, lead a productive life, and not veer away from that thing. And so fathers have that responsibility of training up their children, being a good example. And what makes the work difficult is along comes the devil, just like he did in the Garden of Eden, telling our children, "Oh, you don't really need to listen to your father. Your father's just giving you a bunch of baloney because God told him to say that. Look, you can do what you want to do. You do your own thing." And so then children start looking at their fathers and thinking that they don't have to obey. Just like the serpent convinced Adam and Eve that if they took a bite of the forbidden fruit, they wouldn't die. God wouldn't punish them. But of course, we know what happened. God did punish them, and they did that. And they brought sin and death into the world. So the devil uses the same tricks on our children. So children start developing this attitude of not appreciating the work of their father. Not appreciating all that he has done for them. And oftentimes we will hear the child say the words that I wish we could erase from every language. Or make it a law that says you can't say that, of course, it would not be the First Amendment. And I hate when I hear a young person say, quote, "Well, I didn't time, they don't want that responsibility. And so that child should never make that statement, I didn't ask to be born because the parents made a great sacrifice to bring them into the world, to upbring them in the ways of the Lord, to provide food for them and shelter, home and family. That's part of the honor our Father and our mother. It's by recognizing the sacrifice that they made in order to bring us into this world. I can remember the struggles Jean and I had when we got married. I was still in school. We had our first two sons back to back, close together. One time I was going to class and working two jobs. She was working full time as a manager of Brooks at the mall. And Aaron would wake up in the night, 12 late in the night, to get up and feed me. I'd always go to work with as much sleep or be to school with as much sleep as we wanted. But we wanted it. We wanted it. We made that choice. We wanted to be parents. And so the children should never say, I didn't ask you to do it. Your parents could have not let you come in the world. And then you wouldn't have enjoyed this creation God has made. As children, we should show the same love to our fathers as we as followers of Jesus Christ show to God our Father. When we obey God, if our heart is of the right place or our faith is correct, when we obey God, we do not do it out of fear. We do not do it out of fear of His wrath or judgment. We do it out of a response to the love He has first shown us. As Holy Scripture teaches us, God so loved the world that He gave His only Son. God didn't have to do it. He could have left us in our sin, in our ugliness, in our filthiness, but He didn't want us to be good. He didn't want us to be separated from Him. And so out of love, He sent His Son Jesus, who did willingly, fulfilling His Father's will, goes to the cross to offer up His blood as payment for the sins that we commit so that we might have forgiveness. And the forgiveness comes eternal life. Jesus willingly goes to the cross so that we might have salvation, rises on that third day so we might have eternal life, ascends into heaven, we will come again to judge the living and the dead. So when we serve Jesus, when we serve His church, we do it not out of fear, not in order to earn brownie points with God, but we do it as a response to the love that God first showed us. He loved us that much to send His only Son. And how else can we react to respond in love in return? And that is the way it should be for our Father. That we obey Him. We respect Him not out of fear, not out of being afraid of the wrath, but we respond to them out of love that they first showed us. As I have mentioned to you before, my father was the youngest of three children. When he was 5, which meant his older brother was 7 and his older sister was 9, the man that should have been my grandfather Pollock deserted my dad and his brother and sister and his mother. He was absent the whole time they were growing up. Later in life, he tried to reestablish a relationship with God, and I can remember seeing Dad reading letters from his father. Now, Dad could have reacted as some people do today. He's excused, well, his father ran out on him, so he would be an uncaring father to us. But instead, it had the opposite effect. And my dad told me this several times about my life. But because of the experience he had, he was determined to be the father to me that he didn't have. And so he was it. And he loved us, and he trained my friends tried to get me to go along with him to do something I knew I shouldn't do. I didn't do it not out of fear of being caught, not out of fear of punishment. I didn't do it because my love for my dad was so great I did not want to embarrass him. I did not want to hurt him. I did not want to be ashamed of all him. And so that is why I didn't do certain things. Now, believe me, I was not perfect. And there are shenanigans that I did. And there were things that I shouldn't have done. And fortunately didn't get caught. But major things that would have had major repercussions that some of my friends were doing, I wouldn't do. And it was all because I had a love for my mom and dad. And that is the way we should act toward our parents. I was shocked when I entered college, my freshman year, all these freshmen guys were at one door. I'd sit around and a bunch of guys would be talking, and I was so shocked and amazed to hear so many of these fellow classmates speaking so horribly about their father, saying how much they hated them, or how much they couldn't stand them, or how stupid they were, or whatever. I just thank God that I had such a father that I was blessed with. But part of that was the devil closing her eyes to what their fathers had done. Again, we do not live in a perfect world, and there are those fathers that shirk their duties. There are other fathers, like my grandfather, who desert their families. There are those men who father children and then never take responsibility for them. When I was on a news program, they were interviewing some young man who had fathered like 10 children, 10, 11 children, all like 21. And he didn't support any of them. And when he asked him, did he feel the father's responsibility, he said, well, he said, it's a woman's job to keep them getting pregnant. She got pregnant, she had kids up there. That's what happens when you raise kids without any values or out of any morals. The word of honor. It is the Hebrew word kavod. The Hebrew word means to show courtesy and respect to someone. It means to give weight to them, to give power to them, to give authority to them. It has that meaning of that phrase that we often like to use, talking about someone in authority. That person carries a lot of weight around. So what the commandment is saying, we owe that person our respect and courtesy. Fathers are not to be dismissed, but we are to put our trust in them and our confidence in them. And it is amazing as we grow older how much different our attitude can become. Mark Twain says, quote, when I was 16, I thought my dad was the most ignorant man on earth. When I became 21, I was amazed how much he evolved in 5 years. And that's what a lot of people feel like. At one stage, you think your parents are the dumbest people on earth, and then 5 years later, you're amazed at what they know. But that's what God decided. They have more experience than we do. They've gone through many of the trials that we go through as junior high school, and college. They've gone through all kinds of situations, so they are there to give us that advice and that comfort and that concern. Unfortunately, there are those who want to tell us that in raising our children, we should have a hands-off policy. That we should not put any kind of influence on our children. Let them just grow up as they want, and when they reach adulthood, they'll be where they should be. And we've seen how wonderful that's been. Such children grow up with no value system, no moral code, and no norms to live. Everything is I feel. Not I know because of this or that. I feel. I remember having a discussion with a young person over a tree that was going to be cut down. And some young people were protesting that this old tree was going to be cut down, one because it was dying. why do you think this way? What do you base this on? He said, well, I just feel that. I said, well, beyond your feelings, what are you basing this idea? We need to save this tree. Well, I just feel that way. I said, son, I said, if you told me that you thought that cutting down this tree was a violation of God's command for us to care for the earth and make sure we take care of it in such a way that we can hand it down to our children and our children's children, then I might believe you have a point. But the time you just feel that way, I said, tomorrow you may feel totally different. Feelings are based on outward influences. So children have to have a moral code. They have to have a value system. They have to have moments of living. And that is the role of the father and the mother to see that they develop that. You ask kids today, what do you base your ideas on? Oh, I base it on some of my friends have told me. I base it on what I saw on a TV show. I base it on what I saw in a movie. I base it on some book I read that just some popular novel or something. I based it on what the crowd is saying. This crowd is fickle and change. I can feel it. They need to have that foundation of growing up into this living world of the living. So we fathers are given that responsibility. We look at Israel and we have no better example than what happens when God's word is ignored. When people stop obeying God's word and start doing what they feel like. The 10 tribes of the northern country of Israel totally turned their back on the covenant, which had been made with God. And it began to allow foreign influences in and pagan religions. Soon they had no moral code. They had no value system. And they collapsed. So we are given that responsibility to honor not just our parents, but those in the world, so that our society can be saved. The greatest thing next to worshiping God to honor our Father and Mother. On this Father's Day, let us remember to honor, to respect, and to obey our fathers so that the days may be long in the land which the Lord our God has given us. Amen. Peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds with Christ Jesus.
Those who can, please rise. Please join me on page 104 of the Nicene Creed. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us by our souls. He came down from heaven with his incarnate of the Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
It is good to give thanks to the Lord and to praise his name. And so we come to you, God. prayers and petitions for all who are in need. Our response is, hear our prayer. God of grace and mercy, we praise you for establishing your church through your Son, and for calling us to faith and life as your people. Ever plant the seed of your word among us, and feed us with your table, that you will begin with us, may be brought to the completion in the day of us. Lord Jesus, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of grace and mercy, we bless you for all earthly fathers through whom you have given us in the gift of life. Make them examples to us of your fatherly love, and help them to proclaim to the children your mighty deeds in Christ, bringing them up to nurture and instructions of the Lord of your Lord. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of grace and mercy, let Christ's love so control that we might no longer live for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again for us, nor regard any according to their own will, but earn and see each other as new creations in Christ. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of grace and mercy, at times in his body, your children groan under the burdens and the troubles of life. We remember before you today the trouble, the hurting, the despairing, the anxious, and the grieving. Bless them and all who suffer in his body. Give them your peace, comfort in their troubles, in whatever relief. You know the best for them. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of grace and mercy, we are not worthy of ourselves to stand before you. Let one to come to the table of our Lord to eat Christ's bodies and drink his blood. Still at his invitation, we come. Give us your spirit that we may receive his gifts in the faith of our benefit. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of grace and mercy, we offer your praise, not that we ought, but that we are able. Hear the humble prayers of your people, and grant us all still things that are good and wholesome for us. For into your loving arms we commend all to whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
God of all creation, all you have made us to be, and all your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts that we might be, for the world signs of your gracious presence. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
St. John practices an open communion. For all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, we believe his body and blood are truly present as we gather at his table in our communion age and our individual congregation. We invite and encourage to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of the Lord. We continue our celebration with the great thanksgiving on page 152 in the front of your vision.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, which at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to Almighty and merciful God, to our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us a way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their living hymn. Thank you.
given for you. The body of Christ 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 given for you.
By the Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood, strengthen and preserve you in true faith and the life eternal.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks for what you have set before us. This feast, the body, the blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with Eternal Father's Strong to Save, hymn number 756, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 756.
Thank you. peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. That concludes our 10:30 service. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's Ministries have a outreach store open Monday through Friday, 9:30 to 1, closed on Thursday. Food pantry is open Wednesdays, 9 to 10:45. Rainbow Table is every Friday, noon to 1. Everyone is welcome. Again, thank you for coming to our watching our 10:30 service. Join us at the drive-in at 8 o'clock at the Melody Cruz Drive-In Theater on East 40, east of Springfield. Services held, rain or shine.